Hi Conquerors, this is Dr. Kalyani from Team MBS Conquer. In today's video, we'll be talking about the topic cementum. Cementum is a calcified avascular, a vascular mesenchymal tissue. The outer covering of the anatomic root is cementum. Cementum is of two types. If we see, it's primary and secondary. Primary is also called as a cellular cementum and secondary is a cellular cementum. So apart from that, the two main sources of the collagen fibers in cementum. The collagen fibers can be of extrinsic type or they can be of intrinsic type. If they are extrinsic type, that means from an external source, and that external source is fibroblast. And if it's intrinsic, that is through an internal source, that means they are cementoblasts. Moving on. Here, the cementoblasts not just form the collagenous structure, but also form some non-collagenous compounds like the ground substance, like the proteoglycans, glycoproteins, and phosphoproteins. So, proteoglycans, what is the function? We have learned in my earlier videos that proteoglycans are present as a major composition of the ground substance. They help in regulating the cell-cell-cell matrix interactions, both during normal and development during regeneration of the cementum. So coming on to the cementum composition. So if we see, they are inorganic and organic. In organic, you can see they are collagenous, non-collagenous, proteoglycans, growth factors. So let's come back to the topic of growth factors. Before that, let's see the inorganic content. It's calcium phosphate, hydroxyapatite and trace elements. Collagens are again 1, 3, 5, 6 and 12. You can have a make a list of non-collagens and the ground substance, the proteoglycan. See the growth factors. This is a new terminology and the recent advancements. We will be discussing about this in few slides at the end. If you can see, there are various growth factors like transforming growth factor beta, bone morphogenic proteins, fibroblast growth factor, insulin growth factor, epithelial growth factor, platelet-derived growth factor, cementum-derived growth factor. Make a note of all those growth factors. Now coming on to the cellular cementum. A, cellular, that means without the cementum which composes no cells. It is the first formed cementum and mainly it is seen in the cervical third of the root. The thickness is less, it is around 30 to 230 micrometers. So mostly the sharpy fibers, that is the extrinsic fibers, make up most of the structure of the acellular cementum. So acellular cementum also have some intrinsic fibers. It's not only extrinsic, they also have some intrinsic, but they are also classified but irregularly arranged. Moving on to cellular cementum, the name itself tell you that cellular means having cells. So it is formed after the tooth reaches the occlusion plane. This is not as organized as that of cellula, it's irregular. It contains cells, I told you earlier, so they are nothing but cementocytes. This is less calcified. And here, it is more of intrinsic fibers and sharpies fibers are there, but they occupy a smaller portion of cellular cementum. Okay, so this is the image where you can see a cellular cementum where you don't see anything like cementocytes. You can see a cementoid layer and epithelial rest of melases. Whereas cellular cementum have beautiful cementocytes in between. So if at all there's an image based question where you are able to locate cementocytes, then that's nothing but cellular cementum. Moving on to the fibers. So I already told you extrinsic is the external source. That is Sharpie's fibers, and my previous video I made sure that you learn what are Sharpie's fibers. As you can see, they are with attached periodontal ligament to alveolar bone particularly, and you can see that they are here, we can see that they are present in the cementum also. So coming on to the intrinsic fibers, that is from the internal source, that is the cementoblast itself form these fibers. So these are cementoblasts which are lining like this, that cementum, and you can see that there is cellular mixed fiber cementum and cellular intrinsic fiber cementum. So remember this name, Schroeder in 1986 have given various kind of cementum, I mean the classified cementum based on the presence or absence of cells like acellular, cellular, and based on the fibers they are composed of. So here acellular is fibrillar cementum. It neither contains cells nor extrinsic or intrinsic collagen fibers except for a mineralized ground substance. Acellular afibrillar is a product of cementoblasts and as a seen as a coronal cementum, whereas acellular extrinsic fiber cementum is composed almost entirely of densely packed Sharpe's fibers and they lack cells. You can see that it has fibroblasts and cementoblasts, both are helpful in formation of acellular extrinsic. Cellular mixed, you can make it out everything by the name itself. Cellular is again fibroblast and cementoblast located at the apical third of the roots and in the furcation areas. Whereas the intrinsic fibers, they are only cementoblast related. So these are the images. You can have a look at these images. How there is acellular, afibrillar, how you can see the cementoblast in the case of a cellular. Moving on to the permeability. So permeability means allowing a substance to pass through it is nothing but permeability. So according to this sentence, you can see that the permeability of cementum diminishes with the age. That means in case of a young animal, the permeability is good. So it helps in diffusion of dyes from pulp and external root source. So cemento enamel junction. Yes, this is again an important bit. So basically we see the enamel is in the coronal part, cementum in the root part. The junction of the coronal part of enamel and the root part of cementum is called as cemento-enamel junction. So this junction can be overlapping like in 60 to 65% of cases like this. It can be edge to edge making a butt joint like here. It can be like there's no meeting at all in case of in cementum and enamel like in this 5 to 10% of the cases. But now there's a question. Now they don't give you this question directly. The question would be like, in which cases do you see recession? In which cases following you can see some sensitivity? So that is in this case. That's how the bits come in this particular topic. Now there's something cementodentinal junction. Again, this is important for the bits because you can see this is the cementum and this is a dentin. Though they walk together or they go together, they meet at one end point called as cementodentinal junction. So this cementodentinal junction, here you can see this number one is the minor apical diameter and this is major apical diameter. You mostly see this in endo textbooks. They have a important relation to that of endo because whenever you do a root canal, you can see this, the cementodentinal junction plays an important role and the obturating material should be at the cementodentinal junction. It shouldn't go ahead of it. Moving on to the thickness. Thickness, cementum deposition is a continuous process and that proceeds at varying rates. So cementum formation is most rapid in the apical areas because when the tooth moves to compensate for attrition, the rapid formation of cementum is seen in case of apical areas. In the coronal half, it is thin, like 16 to 60 micrometers. And this is greatest in the apical third and in the furcation areas of the multi-rooted teeth. Secondly, one more area where it will be more is on the distal surfaces, but not on the mesial surfaces of the tooth. Then coming, so this is base, this is the surface, this is in the location, and this is the age. In which age is it more? So it is, the thickness increases threefold as the age grows. So this is about the thickness. You can see how thin is the acellular cementum here and how is the acellular cementum thickness variable. Coming on to abnormality. So everything has an abnormal feature. There's nothing like everything is going to be normal at point of time. There's always an abnormality. That's where we can see that in the cementum as well. So you can either see more cementum like hypercementosis or less cementum like cementum aplasia. So here you can see that the cementum aplasia means there is reduction or excessive production in case of hypercementosis. So it is largely age related phenomena, that's normal. But there are also neoplastic, non-neoplastic conditions where you can see there is a hypercementosis Please make a note of all these features. Hypercementosis occurs as generalized thickening of the cementum with nodular enlargement of apical third of the root. So it can be seen in a spike-like excrescences. For example, that's called as cemental spikes. So that is one type of abnormality which is created. How is it created? By coalescence of the cementicles that adhere to the root or the calcification of the periodontal fibers. So that is called cemental spikes. Please make a note of it. I'll be showing a picture of it in the later slides. Radiographically, there's a difference, it seems. So the diagnostic features, so generally how, why is it this point important for you, is they can be a diagrammatic question being asked. So, if they can show you conditions like periapical cemental dysplasia, condensing osteitis, focal periapical osteoporosis, in these conditions, when you see that hypercementosis, it is in hypercementosis here, the periodontal ligament and the radio opaque lamina dura always seen on the outer border. But where in cases these three situations, what is happening, all these entities are located outside of the shadow of the periodontal ligament and lamina dura. That's how, so you can apply this to a image based question. So here are the images of hypercementosis. Coming to the abnormalities again. So during again excessive tension caused by orthodontic appliances or occlusal forces, yes, you can see hypercementosis. Again, when there is no antagonist tooth, the tooth wants to keep in pace with that of the other occlusal part. So it keeps growing. For that compensation, you can see the certain quality of hypercementosis. And then hypercementosis is seen generalized in Paget's disease. Please make a note of all these conditions because you'll be given it as a question. So apart from that, during other systemic disturbances like acromegaly, arthritis, calcinosis, rheumatic fever and thyroid goiter, also you can see this condition. Make a note of all the local and the systemic causes relating to that of cementum resorptions. So next, resorption and repair. So yes, the resorption and repair occurs hand in hand in case of a cementum. Cementum is a very dynamic structure, and cementum resorption microscopically, they make a bay like concavities in the root surface, and that is like this. If you see, you can see this, this is a resorption lacuna. There is a bay like structure, and the multinucleated Jane cells and large mononuclear macrophages. I told you already that this is the kind of structure of class, osteoclast or cementoclast, which help in active resorptions. So several sites of resorptions may collage and they become a large area. So you can see this alternate periods of the repair and resorption. So that is reversal line. That newly formed cementum is deformated from the root by a deeply staining irregular term called as reversal line, which delineates the border of previous resorption. So coming to the next, repair. Repair requires the presence of viable connective tissue. So some living tissue has to be there for that. Cementum repair can occur in devitalized eyes as well as vitalized. So please remember, it can happen in non-vital as well as vital tooth. There couldn't be a question asked. The epithelial cell rests of melasses are the only odontogenic epithelial that remain in the periodontium. So here the most important is the epithelial cell rests of melasses, and you will see that recent developments of regeneration of cementum is mainly based on this particular cell. This is how the ankylosed tooth look like on a radiograph. You can see there is no demarcation anywhere. And similarly, you can see how the root here is. Seeing the radiograph, you can anticipate how the tooth is going to be while it have to be extracted. Coming to ankylosis, what all of us know, that it's a fusion of cementum and the alveolar bone. The tooth is ankylosed with the bone inside. So this is all about ankylosis. You can see various conditions where ankylosis takes place. Coming on to one more condition called exposure of cementum to the external surface. So because there is a recession here, okay, you can see there is a cementum exposure. So what are the problems against this? So the various cases like recession, loss of attachment due to pocket formation, in all these conditions, you can see there is a cemental exposure. So this is case where the permeability is there, and you can see there is a bacterial invasion of cementum. So these are all the situations which come across when there is a cemental loss. Coming to that of other applied aspects, for your information, as such, cementum was earlier associated with aggressive periodontitis, though it is not to be proven much, but yes, it was earlier proposed by Gottlieb that the cementum is involved, and it was called as deep cementopathia. I have included this slide so that you can remember this name. Deep cementopathia is the other name of aggressive periodontitis. Cementoblastoma, it's a true cementoma. You will be knowing it better. You might have just covered your oral medicine. So this is about the tumor. Coming to cementicles, this is about the true cementicles, which I have already mentioned. Cemental spike, I told you earlier, kind of hypercementosis. Few important aspects about regeneration, which is quite an important topic of research these days. The regeneration of cementum require these molecular factors, and the main part is the epithelial cell rest of melasthenes, which takes place here. So they secrete the matrix proteins like amylogenins, enamelin, sheath proteins, which help in further production of the growth factors like the ones which I specified you earlier. There's one more important protein called cementum attachment protein. So these are also some other proteins like bone siloprotein, osteoprotein, which are helpful. And here is a recent update. Please make a note. You might get it as a bit because it's like a recent concept now. So thank you so much for your patience listening.